It's working? All right, terrific. Well, thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate it. If you mixed me up with Abby Wambach, I believe that she's down the road a little bit. I hope she didn't drive herself. I always find it astonishing when people come to yell outside the building as though it's going to do anything. I'm glad that they're not inside, because if they were trying to shut down this debate, or if they're trying to block access to anybody, that makes you a fascist. Makes you an ideological fascist. If you try to disrupt in the middle of this, you know, there's plenty of time for you to ask questions. I'm happy to have a discussion with you, as you've seen from any of my previous lectures. I spent most of my life having discussions with folks on the other side. The attempt to shut down open debate is a mark of ideological fascists, first and foremost. So first, thank you to YAF, thanks to Young America's Foundation for sponsoring this event. Thanks also to Fred R. Allen for sponsoring this event. And thanks to the College Republicans and to all the other various groups who helped out publicizing the event. Obviously, terrific turnout. I appreciate it. So today we're going to talk about all of these stupid, nonsensical words that you hear on campus from your professors and your administrators and your fellow students that make them feel all warm and special and tingly on their inside bits, but have no relation to reality, have no relationship with reality. And they're mostly used, these terms, to stifle debate, to shut down debate, to prevent opposition from arising to their peculiar and particular point of view. This is really nothing new. This has a long history in the United States, unfortunately, going all the way back to the 1960s and 70s, when the people who are now your administrators were protesters, and they took over the buildings, and then they just sort of stayed. And now their ideological grandchildren are trying to oust these same administrators who probably agree with them simply on the basis of they need change and they feel like protesting today. But today we're going to go through a lot of the terms that these folks use. And these are terms that I'm sure you've heard because you're on campus, and for people who are watching online, you may have not heard these because you exist in the real world where mommy and daddy don't pay the bills and you're not paid to believe in the power of your dreams and no one cares about your feelings. So here are the terms that we're going to go through and talk about today. We're going to talk about diversity. We're going to talk about white privilege, we're going to talk about trigger warnings, we're going to talk about microaggressions, and we're going to talk about safe spaces. So the Hall of Fame of Stupidity. Now, this exercise may in fact trigger some people, so consider this your trigger warning. I don't care how you feel. And if your feelings are hurt, I'm not sorry in any way. No. The reason I say no, I'd be happy to let people in if they're not screaming. The reason I say no is because it's a fire hazard, and the last time people tried to create a fire hazard, they pulled the fire alarm in the middle of a lecture.
Don't give them ideas. And
I know, they don't have many of their own. One of the unfortunate things about facts is that they tend to hurt people's feelings, which is one of the things that I most love about them, since, as I mentioned, I really don't care about people's feelings unless I'm related to them. And I already have a wife, I already have a child, I have a second child on the way, I have parents, I have sisters, I have plenty of people I care about. If you're in this audience, you're probably not one of them. So let's start going through these terms. Let's start with diversity. So as you can tell, I'm sure, from some of the protesters outside, there are a couple of different types of diversity. There's only one type of diversity, however, that the left actually cares about. That type of diversity is not ideological diversity, right? They don't care about differences of opinion and differences of ideas. They don't care about having open discussions and debate. What they actually care about is only one thing, and that is diversity of race. The only thing that is important to the left when it comes to diversity is our relative levels of skin color, our melanin levels. That's what matters most to the ideological left. So to the ideological left, having a group of priests who are giving bread to the poor, but they're all white, is significantly more problematic than having a TV street gang. When I say TV street gang, I mean a racially diverse TV street gang. Not like actual street gangs, which are really not diverse, but like a TV street gang, you know, like with an American Indian and a white guy and a Mexican and a lesbian and, you know, just the whole panoply of humanity in this one street gang. Right? This is what the left likes to think of as the diversity that actually matters. Because all that really matters is our ethnicity or our race, where we come from, Our values don't matter, being a good person doesn't matter, all that matters is diversity of skin color. And we found this out from the left because, for example, when I did speak at Cal State Los Angeles, California State Los Angeles, these protesters are nothing, they should have been at Cal State. Cal State, it was almost literally a riot. I mean, they barricaded the doors, the protesters barricaded the doors, they prevented people from getting in. In a couple of cases, they actually assaulted people who were trying to get into the lecture. In the first place, the reason that this all went bad at Cal State is because, unlike here where the administration helped set up the lecture, at Cal State Los Angeles, the president of the university announced 3 days before I was scheduled to speak that the lecture had been canceled. And here is what he said. He said, quote, "After careful consideration, I have decided that it will be best for our campus community if we reschedule Ben Shapiro's appearance for a later date so that we can arrange for him to appear as part of a group of speakers with differing viewpoints on diversity." I wish I, is it, what are they saying? Oh, okay, great. It's proving my point, there we go. And no, I didn't hire these people, seriously. Just as like it's an illustration of my point. So what he said is, an event with more diversity of viewpoints would better reflect the university's desire for diversity. Therefore, the one guy who has a diverse viewpoint has to be shut down. Right, so in respect to respecting multiple viewpoints, we have to shut down the ones that we don't like. This is also what the left means by tolerance. Right, diversity and tolerance mean diversity and tolerance of one side of the opinion, everybody else shut the hell up. But they do care about racial diversity, right? Racial diversity is deeply important to them. And the question is, why? Why is racial diversity important to them? Now, to me, racial diversity is not particularly important. The reason racial diversity is not important to me is because I care whether you're a good person, not whether you're a white person or a black person. Right? I'd rather be in a room full of good people of any race than a room full of people of diverse backgrounds and skin colors, half of whom happen to be jerks. So, my viewpoint on diversity is this. If you believe that virtue does not matter but skin color does, this makes you a racist. Right? The people who are most racist in life are the people who don't care about virtue, they care only about skin color. That makes you a racist. Doesn't she have like a quilt in it or something? It's fun, it's like whack-a-mole, you never know which exit they're coming from. The left is racist. The left believes that values don't matter, only diversity of skin color matters. Being a jerk, right, that's okay so long as you are of the proper shade, if you are of the proper hue. What underlies this? Why does the left care so much about racial diversity at the expense of, say, being a decent human being? Why do they care so much about this? Well, this is because if you have to boil down the left to one principle, to one value, that value is fairness of outcome. Not equality of opportunity, not we all have an equal shot, not an equal fit, not a fair shot or a fair shake or a level playing field, as President Obama likes to say, equal outcome, right? Equal outcome. If there are two people in a room and one person is rich and the other is poor, something unfair must have happened. This is every Bernie Sanders tweet. Right? Every Bernie Sanders tweet is, isn't it terrible that some people are rich and some people are poor? To which I say, no, it's mostly terrible that some people are poor. Right? I prefer that everybody be rich. But for the left, it's the inequality that's the problem. Right? It's the lack of fairness inherent in the fact that there are people who do better and some people who do worse. Okay. For those who are watching online and can't hear what they're saying Black Lives Matter. I agree. So perhaps you should start expending your resources where black people are being killed, namely by other black people in the inner city. Don't worry, we'll get to all of that. There's a lot to talk about. So, what the left has to come up with, it's okay, don't get a flutter, it'll be all right. Okay, so. The idea is that if there is some sort of inequality in American society, some people doing better, some people doing worse, some groups doing better on average, some groups doing worse on average fiscally, economically, then that must be a reflection of some deeply ingrained racism. It must be a reflection not of individuals making individual bad choices or individuals making individual good choices. It must be about white privilege, right? This is our second term of the day. There was diversity, now we're on to white privilege. White privilege is the idea that if you are born white in America, you are born with certain immutable privilege. You do better inherently than people of another race. You don't have to overcome obstacles that other people have to overcome. Right? White privilege means that you just have it better as a white person than a black person or a Hispanic person solely as a result of race. And this is a really seductive idea. It's a really seductive idea for pretty much everybody. If you're a member of a minority group and you happen not to be doing well at a particular task, it's a nice cop-out. You get to be able to say to folks, well, it's not that I'm making bad decisions or perhaps that I have created obstacles for myself. It's not that. It's that society is unfree. It's that there's somewhere out there in the ether, there's a white privilege that is coming to get me. It's like the spaghetti monster, right? It's coming to get me, and it lives under my bed, and no matter what I do, I can't escape it. White privilege inherently makes my life worse. Right? And if you are a woman, this holds true too. This American society is deeply sexist, it's ingrained. As President Obama likes to say, all of this is in our DNA, there's no way to get rid of it. And so the idea is that you can't affect your own future. You can't live your own life because of this terrible white privilege that exists out there somewhere. Now, when people talk about white privilege or institutional racism, they rarely name the institution that is racist. They rarely name the law that is racist. They rarely name the individual that is racist. Thank you. My wife loves me. Sorry, it is mildly distracting, I will say. But in any case, the idea is that it makes people of minority status feel good to talk about white privilege. It makes white people feel good to talk about white privilege because you are granted a sort of absolution for your white privilege. This is the only way you escape it. If you are a white, heterosexual, cisgender male, and which means that, of course, society, the world is your oyster if you're one of these people, then all you have to do to escape the stigma of white privilege is just say, you're right, it's all on me, I'm creating a worse society. Even if you've never treated a black person badly in your life, even if you think racism is evil, you just have to say over and over, it's my fault, it's a white privilege system, I'm sorry about that, now what can I give you, right? That's the way that we get around white privilege. There's only one problem with this nice, comfortable idea of white privilege, and that is that it is largely bullshit. Okay, the fact is that the idea of white privilege is the founding fathers were a bunch of racist white folks who designed a system that was created, that was in order, that was created. Sorry, folks, having a bit of a security issue. It's Penn State here. I thought it was going to be so nice.
You surprised us.
Yeah, you seem like generally pleasant folks out there. I can't imagine why we don't want to spend time with you. So the idea is that the founding fathers created this inherently white privileged system that nobody can escape, right? Here's why it's bullshit. Okay, the reality is we live in the freest country in the history of the world. If you want to make something of yourself, do it. If you want to make The reason that some people fail and some people succeed in America is because some people make better decisions than other people in America. That's not to say that there isn't privilege. There is privilege. It's what I like to call decision privilege. It turns out that not all decisions are created equal. It turns out, for example, that there is the greatest privilege in America, the greatest privilege, is what I call two-parent privilege. If you grew up in a family with two parents, you are privileged. Now, you're privileged, regardless of your color. Because it turns out that you are going to do better in life and you're going to be better off fiscally and economically if you grow up with two parents. The statistics show that if you are in a black family, you're a black family, you have mom and a dad who are at home with you, you don't have a single parent family, that your poverty rate is going to be 7% in the United States, 7% if you grow up in a black family with two parents in the home. If you grow up in a white family with one parent in the home, your poverty rate is 22%. So, is that white privilege? What happened? You know, did all the KKKers who inhabit our government offices give up on the single white families? Or does it turn out that certain decisions have certain consequences, and that when you have two parents in the home, the kid is likelier to do better? Okay, here's another privilege. This one I call the not committing crimes privilege. It turns out that if you don't wish to go to jail, don't commit crimes. Right? It's actually pretty simple, it turns out. The idea that there are a disproportionate number of black folks and Hispanic folks in prison, that is because, unfortunately, there are more black folks and Hispanic folks committing crimes as relates to their percentage of the population. This is a statistical fact. It may be uncomfortable. Nonetheless, it is true. It has been true for literally decades. The arrest rates match almost precisely the rate at which people report crime. Okay, so the idea is when you report a crime, you give a description of the suspect. Unless there is a vat, and it's not white people who are mostly talking about crime in the black community, it's black people who are usually the victims of other black people committing crimes, just as it is white people who are usually the victims of other white people committing crimes. The percentages of the population reported as having committed crimes precisely match up to the arrest statistics, and they have for at least three decades in the United States. How about the Black Lives Matter movement's contention that when police do come into contact with black folks, they treat them with more violence? Well, that's nonsense too. There's a study that just came out from John Jay College, Professor Peter Moskis, and what he found is that in situations where the police were confronted with force by whites and blacks, the white people were shot significantly more often than the black folks. As early as 1994, I'm sorry, they're called statistics, and they're useful. You should use them. As early as 1994, the Department of Justice... surveyed felony cases in the country's 75 largest urban areas and found lower felony prosecution rates for blacks than whites in the 75 largest urban areas in the United States. How about things like stop and frisk, right? Racial profiling on the street. And the idea that communist moron Bill de Blasio just had is he's going to get rid of stop and frisk because the cops were disproportionately stopping and frisking people of minority descent. There's only one problem with that. When you look to the statistics, again, I like statistics because they're actually useful as opposed to anecdotal evidence, which generally is not. From January to June 2008, to take one example, 98% of all gun assailants in New York City were Hispanic or black. During that same period, stop and frisk targeted 85% of people who were Hispanic or black. In other words, people were statistically under-targeted by race as compared to the percentage of people who were actual gun assailants in New York City. How about driving while black? The idea that cops are randomly waiting on turnpikes for the black guy to drive down the road so that they can nail him because they just watched Birth of a Nation last night and they're gonna get their revenge on the black man by pulling him over for going 35 in a 25 zone. So the idea here is wrong also. So one of the key cases that's used by the left typically here is New Jersey, right? New Jersey, you remember in the 90s there were a lot of headlines about this. You're a little young, but in the 90s there were a lot of headlines about this. The idea was that the New Jersey cops were disproportionately pulling over black people because the New Jersey cops were a bunch of horrible, evil racists. So the DOJ did a full-scale investigation. It was actually Bill Clinton's DOJ did a full-scale investigation. And what they found is that 23% of all drivers in New Jersey who were stopped for speeding were black. 25% of all the people who were speeding were black. So again, it turns out the cops were actually slightly statistically underrepresenting minorities in their pullovers. How about sentencing disparities? The idea that black people are going to prison for longer than white people based on committing the same crimes. Well, it turns out that when you take out the confounds, like past criminal history, as well as the nature of the crime itself, it turns out that those sentencing disparities disappear. This has been true for at least 20 years in the United States. And again, the idea here, one of the sentencing disparities that is most cited is in law. This is an example of institutional racism used this way. Is the disparity between crack cocaine sentencing and powder cocaine sentencing, right? White people use powder cocaine, black people use crack cocaine. This was the theory behind the institutionally racist idea of the disparity. The reason that there is a disparity is because crack cocaine is cheaper, it's more addictive, and it was more easily distributed. It's also true that the people who initially pushed harsher penalties for crack cocaine distributors were black congresspeople from the inner city who were sick of watching their communities ravaged by crack. Go look up the legislative history. But all of this invariably is white privilege. All of this is just white privilege. It's not having to do with individual decisions, don't be a criminal, get married before you have babies. It's all white privilege. When a black guy knocks up his black girlfriend and takes off, that's white privilege. Right? When a white guy knocks up his white girlfriend and takes off, that's not white privilege. Right? It turns out that when anybody knocks up their girlfriend and takes off, that makes you a jerk. Right? It has nothing to do with privilege. It has to do with you being a bad person. But it's all attributable to white privilege. Everything is attributable to white privilege. When black people riot in Baltimore, a majority black city, against a majority black police department, with a black police chief, a black mayor, a black president, a black attorney general, a majority of the city council that's black, and all 15 who are Democrats, that is just an impact of white privilege. Or perhaps, you know, as long as we're talking about disparities in group outcome, let's talk about the real privilege in American society. Let's get down to it. Let's look at the real privilege in American society. All the Asians. I mean, boy, because it turns out that Asians are about to surpass white people, or already have, in terms of group income. It also turns out that Asians get into top colleges at a higher rate. than white people or black people or Hispanic people, which is why, back a few years ago, Princeton University did a study, and what they found was, this is when the SATs were out of 1600, so back in my day, when the SATs were out of 1600, Princeton University found that black folks were being given a bonus of 230 points on average by the top universities in the country. Asians were being penalized by 50 points. But that's fair, because Asians were obviously beneficiaries of Asian privilege, because our Asian founders wrote an Asian constitution to benefit Asian people. In case you were wondering, that's why our constitution is in Korean. So it turns out that white privilege is largely nonsense. It is largely nonsense. And most of all, white privilege is used as a way to shut down debate. Because the idea is that someone shouts at you white privilege, that means as a white person you can't possibly understand anything that's going on anymore. You can't understand, you can't be part of the debate, you have to shut up. Right? And, institutional racism is the same thing. The left shouts institutional racism, and then you say, okay, what are you proposing? And they propose something that invariably involves the government becoming larger and invading people's rights. You say, I don't like that policy. And they say, ah, that's because you're part of the institutional racism. The nice thing about vague conspiracy theories is they can justify virtually any behavior. But what happens when it turns out that no matter how much you complain about white privilege and institutional racism, you still can't achieve that equality of outcome? It turns out that no matter what, reality always intervenes. Well, then we have to come up with a different metric for equality. So we can't have equality of material outcome. Now what we need is equality of feelings. We all need to feel special. We all need to feel self-esteem just warming us at night. And the only way to make that happen is to make sure that you never hear anything with which you disagree. You must be protected from alternative points of views. And so we have trigger warnings. Trigger warnings designed to protect you from all of the things you fear, like people who disagree with you. Right? So repetitive. Here from the Harvard Crimson just a couple of days ago, as a student wrote, in a class I attended earlier this semester, a large portion of the first meeting was devoted to compiling a list of rules for class discussion. A student contended that as a woman, she would be unable to sit across from a student who declared that he was strongly against abortion, and the other students in the seminar vigorously defended this declaration while the professor remained silent. Right? You cannot be confronted with ideas that you don't like, or if they are ideas you don't like, they can't come from a person who's not allowed to have those ideas, because that would just be too much. That would just be too disturbing. We wouldn't want anybody to be triggered, because if they're triggered, then you never know what happens. They might end up like these precious snowflakes outside who can't bear to hear a dissenting opinion, and so they have to shout people down. Right? Those dissenting snowflakes must be preserved at all costs, lest they melt in the face of reality and fact. Which brings us to microaggression. So, when the trigger warnings fail and somebody says something that offends you, then you call it a microaggression. Now, the language of microaggression is deeply evil. It is. The word itself is evil. The reason it's evil is because it suggests that things you don't like that I say, these are aggressions, to be met with aggression, to be met with violence, right? To be met with men with guns. Right? If somebody says something you don't like, you get to call the dudes with the guns. Here's a quick rule for folks. If your rule is that you hear something you don't like, so you call the guys with the guns to shut it down, that makes you the bad guy. Right? And this is what happens at University of Missouri, where, for example, the students were told that if their feelings were hurt, they should literally call the cops. They were literally told that at University of Missouri 6 months ago. In America, that's not a crime, that's free speech. But the problem is that this has infused the entire left. The idea that if you are, or at least large swaths of the left, the idea that if you say something offensive, if you say something that you don't even mean to be offensive, but it's subjectively taken as offensive, that you have aggressed somebody in some way. Right? So if you say he instead of she, or if you say he or she instead of ze, which isn't even a word, or if you say things like, where are you from, right? Or if you say things like, I am colorblind, these are all microaggressions. Not because you meant them to be offensive, not because they objectively are offensive, but because somebody found them offensive. Right? We have an equality of subjectivity. The equality is that whatever is going on in that crazy little brain of yours, we all have to pretend that it's reality, and if we disagree with that reality, then we have to assume that you're going to react with violence. My favorite story about this, and I'm sure the protesters would love this one, I don't know how many of you watch CNN headline news. The answer is probably close to zero. It has terrible ratings. But but I was, for if you want to check, you can check this out on YouTube. I was on CNN headline news, sort of been about 8 months ago now. This is around the time when Caitlyn Jenner was becoming a national hero, and there was a conversation nationally going on as to whether Caitlyn Jenner should be formally awarded the Medal of Honor or actually be given sainthood by the Pope. And they decided to have me on because ESPN was going to give Caitlyn Jenner the Heroism Award, because nothing says heroism quite like having a couple of surgeries, some hormone injections, and being extremely wealthy wearing rich brocades. That is the definition of Normandy-style heroism to me. So my perspective on transgenderism is clear. It's been clear for a long time. I don't believe that men can become women. I don't believe that women can become men. There is such a thing as genetics. It's called biology. And I don't believe that because you think you're a woman, that makes you a woman. And I feel terrible. I honestly feel terrible for people who suffer from the mental illness that is gender dysphoria. And I don't think that it is right. I think it's actually cruel to humor delusion by suggesting that surgery is going to cure it when surgery results in precisely the same suicide rate post-surgery as it did pre-surgery. Okay, so this has been my perspective for a very long time. So they want to have me on the show to discuss all of this. So the producer comes up to me right before the show, and the producer says, our ratings here are terrible. Right? It's an open secret at CNN Headline News, the ratings are terrible. So he says, our ratings are terrible. And so we're having you on. As the only conservative in a 300-mile radius in Los Angeles, we're having you on to discuss this particular issue. And I said, okay, sounds good, happy to do it. And this is when I should have known things were going to go wrong, since I used to produce for Jerry Springer. And I said, all right. He says, well, here's how the panel's going to go. You're going to sit down. We're going to ask a few questions. It should be easy. It should be friendly. It's an open conversation. And I want you to say what you really believe. And I said, okay, well, I have a habit of doing that. So they put me in the panel. And it's me and there are, I think, six other people on the panel. Six other people, and they're all leftists. It's me and six leftists, which makes it almost fair for them. And so the conversation is going on, and people are just determining whether Caitlyn Jenner, and the entire conversation is legitimately, should Caitlyn Jenner be given an honorary burial slot in Arlington National Cemetery? Should we build statues of Caitlyn Jenner on the National Mall? And then finally they come to me, and I say, I don't understand why as a society it's beneficial for us to engage in mass delusion. And this does not go over well. And it turns out the person who they've sat next to me is a fellow named Zoe Ter. Zoe Ter is a transgender male to female, formerly Bob Ter, a reporter in the Los Angeles area. And Zoe doesn't like what I'm saying, and so Zoe turns to me and says, you don't know anything about science, little boy. And I said, well, I know what genetics are, and I know that Bruce Jenner, all of the cells in Bruce Jenner's body, with ironically, the exception of some of his sperm cells, all of them have Y chromosomes, right? All of them. And he says, well, there are genetic questions about that. And I said, well, what are your genetics, sir? And it was the sir that set him off. And right hand to God, I honestly, it did not even occur to me that this would be offensive. This is just because I call men sir and I call women ma'am. And his voice was an octave lower than mine. And so he proceeds, at this point, he proceeds to reach over in the middle of the panel and literally grab me by the back of the neck. I was on national TV, live television. He grabs me by the back of the neck and he says to me, if you don't cut that out, you'll go home in an ambulance. Which, first of all, doesn't make sense because you don't go home in an ambulance. Here's the punchline. What was really shocking about it is not this whole thing, which was mildly shocking, I have to admit. It's been a while since I had someone try to commit assault and battery on me on national TV. But the other six people on the panel immediately swiveled on me, right? And it was, how dare you say something that offensive to Zoe? You knew that was going to make Zoe do that. And, well, I sure as hell didn't. But they said, in fact, when this happened, I said, this seems mildly inappropriate for a political conversation. They all turned on me because the idea was I had said something that offended Zoe Ter. Therefore, it was okay for physical violence to be used and physical threats to be issued. Right? And the physical threats, by the way, continued for the rest of the evening. As Zoe was walking off set, he turned to me and growled at me, I'll see you in the parking lot, and then tweeted at me later that he wanted to curb stomp me. All of which I had to admit I felt was deeply unladylike behavior. But this is the totalitarianism of the microaggression culture. You can think I'm wrong. You can think that everything I'm saying is nonsense. You can think all of that. That's all right. That's free speech. That's cool. What you can't do is use physical violence or threats of force in order to shut down debate from the other side. That's totalitarianism, and that's what microaggression culture is. If you want to say what you said offended me, maybe you want to clarify, that's okay. That's fine. But the minute you start calling things microaggressions, you're getting into territory where you're already labeling verbiage aggression. You're labeling verbiage aggression. And once you label verbiage aggression, then you're in dicey totalitarian territory. Wait, did they assign homework at this school? Like, do you guys learn anything? I mean, I guess when it's winter and there's nothing on TV, but... Okay. So, finally, once you've gotten rid of all of the trigger warnings, you've prevented people from saying offensive things, and you've enshrined the microaggression culture, then you finally get to the utopia, the wonderful utopia of the safe space. You've created the safe space. That's not actually a free space. It's a fascist space. It's a space where nobody is allowed to disagree with you. You get to live in this utopia of your own making that simply doesn't apply once you leave the halls of academia. Right? You do this kind of crap at your job, you're getting fired. Right? Because it turns out that the safe spaces that you want to create, they don't exist in the real world. They only exist in your crazy fever-rattled brain. What's happening with all of this, with white privilege and microaggressions and trigger warnings and safe spaces and diversity of race but not diversity of thought, all of this creates morally, ethically, and mentally stunted individuals. It creates a generation of snowflakes who are ready to melt. It creates a generation of lilies who are going to wilt. Okay, it creates a generation of people who are incapable of entering the real world and succeeding. Jonathan Haidt is a psychologist at New York University, and he says, quote, "The recent collegiate trend of uncovering allegedly racist, sexist, classist, or otherwise discriminatory microaggressions doesn't incidentally teach students to focus on small or accidental slights. Its purpose is to get students to focus on them and then relabel the people who have made such remarks as aggressors." For the psych majors in the room, you know this is the opposite of cognitive behavioral therapy, which is really the only proven form of psychotherapy that works. And that is, if you're having a group of thoughts, a chain of thoughts that leads to a bad outcome, the best thing that you can do is teach people where they're going wrong. Right? You can actually say to them, you know, you think that person means to offend you. Maybe they don't mean to offend you at all. Maybe they're just saying something with which you disagree. Maybe you shouldn't care so much what they say. Right? That is healthy thinking. Unhealthy thinking is shut that person down. And not only that, it leads to violence. Right? It leads to violence because when you tell people that they are victims of rhetoric and therefore they get to react with violence, you're leading to a more violent culture. It creates adults unwilling to face up to reality. Roy Baumeister is a psychologist from Columbia, and he has a book called Evil Inside Human Violence and Cruelty. Very good book. And he talks in there about all of this. He says, hypersensitive people who often think their pride is being assaulted are potentially dangerous. Even when a neutral observer would conclude that no serious provocation occurred, it is still important to recognize that in the perpetrator's own view, he or she was merely responding to an attack. So I guarantee you, for example, that all the folks out in the hallway, none of them have ever listened to a word that I've ever said. They've never read a word that I've written. But they've taken it as offensive. I'm a racist. They know I'm a racist because they feel that I'm a racist. They can't say, if I walked outside right now, which I won't for security reasons, if I were to walk outside right now and ask them to cite something that I had said that was racist, they couldn't find anything because I don't say racist things. But it makes them feel good. It makes them feel the sense of victimhood. And in our culture, victimhood is equal to virtue. And if victimhood equals virtue, the highest form of victimhood is victimhood that strikes back. And so virtue lies in doing violence to your political opponents or shutting them down or disrupting free speech events or taking all of the fascist totalitarian tactics that you see on a regular basis now. Here's the bottom line. America is the greatest place in the history of the world for two reasons. One is because we get to say what we think. And you know what? You don't have to care what I think. Right? This is a free country. If you don't want to be here, you're free to leave. And if you want to disagree with me, you're free to do that too. Right? One reason is because America is a place where you get to say what you think without fear of the government cracking down on you. Civilization is the notion that I get to participate in free behavior and you don't get to hit me for it. And the second reason that America is the greatest place on earth is because freedom means that your actions are correlated with your level of success. And what you do in life, the decisions that you make, if you make meritorious decisions, then you succeed in life, and if you make non-meritorious decisions, you are likely to fail in life. The left is out to destroy both of these concepts. They are out to destroy the idea that you can say what you want, because you can't say what you want. This is why 40% of people who are age 18 to 34, our age group, right, 40% of people in our age group believe that the United States government should prosecute people who say things that are objective, that are offensive to minorities. This would involve repealing the First Amendment. Over 70% of college students believe there should be speech codes on campus that prevent people from saying offensive things. And when it comes to obliterating the connection between cause and effect, between good action and good result, the left does that too by teaching entire generations of Americans that no matter how hard they work, no matter how hard they try, there are too many obstacles in their way to ever succeed, so they might as well throw their hands up and simply assume the system is out to get them, and if they fail, it's everybody else's fault. This obliterates the freedom upon which the nation is built. It obliterates the bases for the most powerful and free nation in the history of the world. We should be able to agree on these two things, honestly. This is the meaning of liberty. Say what you want, act how you want, and bear the consequences. This is the meaning of freedom. And if you disagree with this, right, there should be unity of values in this, if nothing else. If you disagree with this, this is not in accordance with basic Americanism. So let's all come around. It's basic decency and basic humanity, these should be pretty rudimentary concepts. Unfortunately, they no longer are. So every American of goodwill, left, right, and center, should be fighting on behalf of these types of American freedom, even if we disagree on taxation, even if we disagree on how much force should be used by the U.S. military. We can agree on these things. And if we can't agree on that, the country truly is at an end. I don't think it is. I think we can agree on that if we're willing to listen to each other, and that's why events like this are important. Thank you so much for coming, and happy to take your questions. Well, you're not responsible for it. Individual responsibility.
What advice can you give to someone who is conservative stepping into a world that it feels like is increasingly anti-conservative?
I mean, the only advice I would say is you have to walk toward the fire, meaning that it is a hostile world. You have to embrace the fact that it's a hostile world and stand up for yourself. I mean, I think that what tends to happen is all of these attitudes about white privilege and institutional racism and calling people who are conservative inherently racist and calling them sexist, bigot, homophobes, etc. Yeah, all of this is an attempt to shut you up and make you quiet down. And I don't think that you have to shut up or quiet down. And I also don't think that you are obligated in any way to answer charges of racism with argument with full-on discussions. I think it's actually a waste of time. Because all that is it's a character slur. It's not an argument. It's an emotional appeal, not an actual argument. So, you know, next time somebody calls you a racist, the proper answer is not, let me explain to you all the reasons why I'm not a racist. The proper answer is, you have no evidence I'm a racist, but you're calling me a racist anyway. That makes you a jackass. Right? So in other words, you can be aggressive in defense of your values. It's okay to be aggressive in defense of your values because the left sure as hell is aggressive in promotion of their values. And since I believe the left values are essentially evil, I think that we ought to be fighting it at every turn.
Hey, I'm probably one of the few Democrats in this room.
Well, thanks for coming. I appreciate it.
No, actually, I do want to say thank you for coming, too, because as much as we may disagree, I do believe in free speech.
So well, thank you. This is, and by the way, this is why you'll notice throughout the speech, I use the word left, right? I say leftist. Mm-hmm. I don't say liberal. The reason I don't say liberal is because people have tended to confuse the two. But liberal traditionally meant that you believed in basic values like free speech, right? So if we're on the same page there, then at least we have something to build on. I appreciate that.
We have several things. I just have two questions.
Sure.
Do I have to take one or can I just talk to it?
It depends how quickly you can speak.
Really quick. Okay, go for it. The first is, so I also got in hot water, just like you did from saying something. What I said specifically was about students for Trump, and I know that you have a little bit of a controversy with Trump, too.
Oh, yes, you've been watching the news.
People who gravitate, or people who commit hate crimes, whether past or future, are going to gravitate to students for Trump, and I want to know your opinion on that statement.
Okay, so I think that it depends on the sort of hate crime you're looking at. I don't think all hate crimes are one-sided, meaning first of all, I don't believe in the concept of hate crime as a general rule, because I think that the victim of the hate crime doesn't care too much what the motivation of the attacker was. If somebody gets beaten to death, the dead person, I don't care about why the person did it nearly as much as I care about what the person did. I care about behavior more than I care about thought. But if what you're really asking, I think is what you're really asking, is why is there a certain group of racist people who tend to gravitate toward the Trump campaign?
Yes.
Okay, so I think that racism exists on all sides of the political aisle. Right? I think that racism certainly exists in the ranks of Barack Obama. I think it certainly exists in the ranks of Hillary Clinton. And I think that there is a group, I've been very honest and open about this, and I know that there are people in this room probably identify with this group. I feel that there's an alt-right group, which is a small minority of Trump voters, who are happy to engage in racist rhetoric, saying racist things, because they believe that it's some sort of free speech defense. I disagree with this as a general rule. Okay, it doesn't mean that I want government to prosecute them for that. I don't. I think that the government only prosecutes for behavior, not for speech. But I do think that I'm not somebody who believes that racism doesn't exist. My objection is you don't get to claim racism when there is none. So when I receive, from a Trump supporter one of these anti-Semitic memes, and I can't tell the difference between their meme and David Duke's meme, and David Duke does tweet anti-Semitic memes at me, right? When I can't tell the difference between the memes, that's your problem, right? That's not my problem. It's not an interpretational problem on my end. And it doesn't make you an advocate for freedom because you sit up at night masturbating in your room and creating anti-Semitic memes. Right? You're not a free speech warrior, right? You're just a loser. So, and I do find that the alt-right group, for a variety of reasons, gravitates toward the candidacy of Trump as opposed to some of the other Republican candidates. I think that's because Trump tends to be more nationalist than conservative. I don't think he's conservative. I think he's a nationalist populist. And a lot of the alt-right people are not conservative either. They're nationalists first, and they believe that nationalism boils down to if you are quote-unquote native, meaning if you're a white person living in the United States, then you deserve special privileges that don't accrue to people in other countries who immigrate here. And I'm not saying that that's Trump's total perspective, but I think there are some Trump supporters, again, a minority of Trump supporters, a small minority of Trump supporters who feel that way. I don't want to say all Trump supporters do this because it's not true, but I will say that there is a small group of Trump supporters who do this.
And then secondly, real quick, I have seen oversensitivity in places I work, and so I kind of can buy from that. Mm-hmm. But like on another topic, I'm trying to like decriminalize weed here in Pennsylvania in State College. I want to know what your opinion is. Weed, yay or nay?
So decriminalization of weed, yay, weed, nay. Okay, meaning that, I'm libertarian when it comes to weed. I will also say that the...
I'm not going to attack you, bro. I'm not going to attack you.
I didn't think you were going to. You're high. weed's a downer. So in any case... So to finish the thought, I'm for decriminalization of weed, but I find people who smoke weed to be losers. So that's my brief summation, because it kills your brain cells and it's a waste of time.
So I'm a conservative, and I'm a sociology major with hopes of doing advocacy work, which I find out that sociology is one of the most, if not like.
Yeah, I was going to say, cognitive dissonance a lot. Yeah.
One of the most liberal professions out there. And so I was just kind of curious as to how does one go about challenging this type of dialogue in a way that speaks to conservative values rather than just this system that has been set up to really help the left?
Okay, so I mean, inside the sociological profession or inside the school?
Just in the sociology profession.
Well, I mean, unfortunately, the sociology profession, from what I understand, is dominated by government-run jobs, and government-run jobs tend toward the left, because when the government funds things, that involves the seizure of private assets in order to do it, and the people who are in favor of that tend to be on the left. As far as speaking out, and this is a general rule for all conservatives, be smart about it. Don't get yourself fired over your political perspective. If you're a conservative student, you have a leftist professor, and the leftist professor is going to grade you down, just write like a communist. It's fine. This is how I graduated summa cum laude from UCLA. In class, I spoke like Milton Friedman or Frederick von Hayek, and then on my tests, I wrote like Bernie Sanders. And it was, and the tests were anonymous, so I would write my student ID number, so they never knew. But if you would dig it up right now, I'd be like, whoa. So the idea is be smart, because it's better to be successful in life and then use that success against the left than it is to let them quash you now. So it was much better to go to UCLA, graduate summa, go to Harvard Law, graduate cum laude, do all of that in the bowels of the left. And now whenever I say Harvard Law, they at least they can't call me stupid because all of their favorite people graduated from Harvard Law. So it makes it hard for them.
So first I'd like to thank you for coming. I don't agree with everything you say, but I'm a people who really appreciate you coming down here and having a political discussion as well as you had fun coming down.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
So there's a BDS movement where, I'm not sure if you're aware of this.
I'm fully aware of it, yeah.
So a lot of students are protesting their colleges that divest from Israeli companies.
Right.
One of the schools, I'm not sure which UCAL school did it, but their administration recognized anti-Zionism with that movement, and then associated that with anti-Semitism
right.
as a hate crime.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you fall on that? Do you feel like...
Anti-Zionism is anti-Semitism. Yes, the State Department definition of anti-Semitism includes the idea that if you treat Jews differently than you treat non-Jews, or if you treat the Jewish state differently than you treat any other state, that's a facet of anti-Semitism. I agree with that. If the idea is that the Jewish state does not have a right to exist, but all the Muslim states around it have a right to exist as Muslim states, that is clearly a facet of significant hatred for one particular group. Like, I have no problem with there being Muslim countries. I don't have a problem with there being Christian countries. And I certainly don't have a problem with there being a Jewish country. The idea that the Jewish country has to be targeted for destruction is an element of singling out the Jews that I can only term Jew hatred. I've been, very vocal on this particular score.
I had two questions. One of them was regarding your characterization of the left as fascist. You mentioned that there's essentially an unbroken lineage between modern leftism and their grandparents back in the 1968 revolution.
Yes.
But I'd like, looking at where they came from, they were screaming Marx now and Marcuse in the streets
right.
in 1968. Marcuse
right.
was one of the cultural Marxists in Frankfurt School.
Right.
They were coming up with deconstructionist theories on tear apart the West.
Right, no, I'm more of the Frankfurt School, yeah.
And then back to Gramsci, basically back to Bolshevik Revolution.
That's right.
Why not? It sort of muddles the issue, calling them fascists and then saying that Nazis are, gay liberals in BSDM costumes.
I've never said that predictably, so that's weird. Okay, so number one, the Nazis were up the left. The Nazis were up the left. And if you read Hitler's books, if you read Mein Kampf, what you find is that he was very heavily influenced by Marx. Right? The split between the National Socialists and the Communists was a split over power, not over fundamental principle, and the fact is that Communists were fascists. I mean, Stalin was a fascist. I mean, fascist was a system of government that suggested that a top-down elite ought to rule every aspect of life, and the economic system that has been traditionally attached to that is one that involves seizure of private property and redistribution of it, which is something that both Hitler and Stalin did. So there is a high correlation between the left of today and the fascist left of today and the fascist left of yesteryear. I don't draw a massive distinction, really ideologically, between Nazism and communism because they both have the same source. It's just that the Nazis tended toward nationalism and the communists tended toward internationalism. This was their main conflict.
And then one other question. Essentially, the point of this lecture was the diversity and its aspects, but you regarded it mostly as neutral for most of the lecture. You're more concerned with its character, which I think is good. But I would submit Putnam and Robert Putnam and Arthur Schlesinger in Disuniting of America,
yep.
The hostility of one tribe for another is among the most instinctive human reactions. Mass migrations have produced mass antagonism since the beginning of time.
Right.
Schlesinger, looking at the list of the most trusting places,
I know the Putnam argument. So I know where, and the Putnam argument, essentially, and he's made this argument now. Putnam's a leftist, by the way, Robert Putnam. And he's very upset with the idea. He wanted to go with the diversity is our strength argument, but it turned out that in many cases diversity was not our strength when there was diversity of values. There are three types of diversity I really only talked about two. I talked about diversity of thought, right, and I talked about diversity of race, right, diversity of ethnicity. There's a third type of diversity that's slightly deeper, and that's diversity of values. Within diversity of thought, there can be disagreements, right? But at the very end, as I suggested, there are certain values we all have to hold in common, right? And those values that we have to hold in common are deep and abiding and cross-racial, or can be cross-racial. So what Putnam found in that same book that you're talking about, and when he studied this issue, what he says is racial diversity, without any other driving factor, all it does is create more protest marches and interracial conflict. The exception to this is when people have a common goal in a community. which is why we have to have social fabric. It's why we all have to agree on basic values, like freedom of speech, like basic decency, like don't knock some girl up and run away, like make sure that you pay for things, like my, you know, taking care of my wife is my business and taking care of your wife is essentially your business. Right? We have to agree on values. If you do that, then racial diversity is a neutral. It doesn't make a difference at all. Because racial diversity has nothing, once you don't have diversity of deep values, and we all have the same values, who cares what color your skin is? The problem with diversity is when there is a diversity of value systems entirely. And even the left agrees with this, by the way. The left, for example, wouldn't suggest that a community is made richer by a group of people who come in and then suggest, for example, that they get to just kill everyone. Right? This is not a community that's been made richer by a diversity of values. So the solution is so racial diversity correlates with conflict when there is no commonality of values. The solution that I have suggested, and the traditionally American solution, is that we need commonality of values and unity of values, and then racial diversity becomes a neutral.
My question to you is, you talk about free speech and how free speech, don't care what other people say. This very much goes to the campaign finance type of question.
Uh-huh.
Do you believe that corporations have free speech and therefore should be able to donate as much money as they can?
Yes, and the reason I say that is because the New York Times is a corporation. Right? If you're going to say that corporations can't have free speech, then no corporation can have free speech, no corporation can speak. Right? And if you can just shut any corporation down based on the fact that it is organized legally as a corporation, then you can kiss the entire press goodbye. Right? The press is over. This is the idea that corporation, I mean, I'm a lawyer, right? So lawyers know all a corporation is a legal filing. I could become Ben Shapiro LLC literally tomorrow with an $800 deposit in Sacramento. Should I then be barred from speaking my mind? No, it's silly. It's silly. The reason, the idea that because I filed the corporate filing, now I've been barred from free speech is silliness. So I don't understand why legal filing should impact this. The real complaint is that rich people somehow get to buy more stuff. Well, welcome to America, where rich people get to buy more stuff.
Yeah. My thing of that is that they're donating all the super PACs. If it's all for free speech, it's still donating to individual candidates up to $5,400. So why do you not have an equal playing field where everyone can donate up to have a limit that's equal for everyone? Why do you give some people the ability to donate more money than others? Just because they don't want
to. Because we live in a free country where you can spend your money how you want. I don't force you to buy a certain number of socks, I don't force you to buy a certain number of TVs, and I don't force you to spend money on a candidate or not. If I want to spend, by the way, the idea that there's a high correlation between, you know, people spending a lot of money on campaigns and victory, Jeb Bush would tell you otherwise. That's a leading question, but yes. So I'll just jump right on that landmine. Yes, I think that when Donald Trump says things like, if somebody is a protester and you don't like what they're saying, essentially, punch them in the face and I'll pay your defense bills, yes, this is problematic. When he says, you know, years ago, they just would have taken that guy out of here on a stretcher. I don't think that that's appropriate language. Yes, I agree. And when he says on national television that he will pay for, he's thinking about paying the defense bills of a white guy who punches a black guy out for no reason at a rally, yeah, I think that makes you kind of gross. I think that's indecent.
Also, my second question is, as a upper middle class white male, I've had multiple trying to have open debates or discussions with people. I've been shut down with the white privilege defense. What have you seen as the best way to move forward after that defense? And continue the open discussion without just all social
media. Well, I mean, if they won't let it go, there's no way to continue the discussion. White privilege is a character argument. It's not an actual discussion topic, right? They don't mean that let's open a discussion about historic racism in America and what impact it has on things today. What they mean is you don't get to talk because you're white, and therefore you can't escape your parochial perspective. So your perspective's already been written out of the conversation. So you wasting your time discussing with somebody who just keeps saying white privilege at you, That's a waste of time, because what they're saying is until you assume the mantle of moral inferiority in this conversation, we're not going to continue. And you don't need to do that. Why should you do that? I mean, you're not morally inferior unless you've been going around discriminating against black people, in which case you are. But if you haven't been, then you know, you don't. There's no reason for you to be defensive of, you know, a grand system for which you are supposedly responsible, even though you were born 20 years ago.
So my colleagues here felt it was necessary to come up and say I'm a Democrat or I'm a Republican. I guess one big question, especially when it comes to diversity, is why are we not talking about being Americans again, as a whole? I'm a big believer in coming to the center, etc. I think black, white, pink, purple, red, and blue come together, and it's ideological and very big dreaming. But that conversation is not really brought up that we're Americans. We fought and bled together in dozens of wars. Why is it that we've got to go towards these negative aspects of each party, and we're not coming together and saying, hey, we got a terrorist country state over there that's going to kill us all?
Well, I mean, listen, first of all, I think that, you know, I think that at the end of the conversation, that's essentially what I was saying, is, right, we should be able to come together across political aisles on a few basic principles, even if we disagree about same-sex marriage, right? Like, we should be able to come together about these certain basic principles. I'm not going to pretend that I don't think the political debate is important. I do. I think that the one of the big problems that's happened really in my lifetime, but starting slightly before, is the intense attempt to fragment the definition of liberty. So in President Obama's second inaugural address, he said, what makes America so great is that we can all have different definitions of liberty. And I thought to myself, well, actually, that's the one thing we probably can't have different definitions of. If your definition of liberty is invading my rights, then we disagree fundamentally on what the country is about. What I see increasingly is a polarization in the very nature of the terms we are supposed to be standing for. And that's what I'm fighting. I'm fighting the idea that liberty is to be perverted into a sort of tyranny because we have to feel good about ourselves. That's what I'm fighting. And I label that the left, and I see that more on the left than I do on the right.
So do you think a third party could be influential or probably key cogging machine that we could use?
Well, I mean, I think that
large group of people that doesn't believe on these far sides, whether it's one, you know, group that's...
I mean, I think that that's more of a structural question than it is a political one. I mean, there are people who would disagree with any president or any presidential candidate. You know, the system is sort of built as a two-party system. It's just the way that it works, and it has pretty much always. So will a third party ever be successful? Not unless it replaces one of the other two, probably.
These are our last two questions.
I'd like to say thank you for coming. And then I have two questions. They're separate. But one is, can you make a comment on why the left protects Islam when their values go against everything the left stands for? And how many more attacks do you think it will take until the left recognizes the eventual outcome of the migrant crisis?
Okay, so they're really sort of the same question. The reason...
No, I have a second question.
Oh, okay. sorry, there was your question mark. So I assumed. The reason that the left protects Islam in a way that it doesn't protect other forms of religion is it goes back to the fundamental principle I was speaking about earlier, fairness of outcome, right? So the problem is that if you look at the world today, Muslim countries tend to be incredibly poor. The people there tend to be very oppressed. The people there do not have freedom. They don't have nice things. You wouldn't want to live in Pakistan. It seems like a crappy place to live. So the left's response to this is, the reason that this must all be happening is because the West has somehow made these people subservient. Somehow the West is responsible for this. The West is rich, the world of Islam is generally not, and therefore the West must have somehow victimized the world of Islam in some way. So we have to be very sympathetic to all of their claims and all of their views. President Obama says this in the introduction to Dreams from My Father. He specifically says that the same despair that drives terrorists in Jakarta, Indonesia, is the same despair that he sees on the streets of South Side of Chicago. Well, it's not precisely the same kind of despair, because kids on the South Side of Chicago aren't running into buildings and blowing themselves up. Right? So it ain't quite the same. But you know, it's sort of a Marxist undertone, which is, in order to ensure equality of outcome, we have to assume that people who are poor must have been victimized by people who are rich, even if the people who are rich because their value system is better.
And would you ever consider running for
Well, I mean, apparently, according to the Republican race this time around, literally anyone can do it. so sure, why the hell not?
Last question.
Thanks, Ben, for coming. My question is, with this presidential election, we've seen the Republican Party split between the establishment and the anti-establishment. And that gave me hope that now we're seeing the anti-establishment split between Trump and Cruz.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see any way of winning this election?
I mean, I always thought that presidential elections are uphill for Republicans because, like, Mitt Romney could have won Florida, Virginia, and Ohio and still lost the election of 2012. Right? The Democrats have many paths to winning the election. Republicans have one. They have to win Florida, Virginia, Ohio, and then they have to win a couple more states like Colorado and Iowa or Wisconsin or Pennsylvania or Michigan. So they had to win a lot of states in order to win, and they're only going to win narrowly. So, you know, Hillary's a very vulnerable candidate. I think that it's unbelievable that Republicans have an unerring instinct for picking the worst possible candidate. So the most unpopular person in the history of American politics, maybe, is Hillary Clinton. So Republicans go out and find literally the most unpopular person on planet Earth. Right? And they say, that guy, he's the one. We need him. Right? The guy who has disapproval ratings among his key constituency group, right? Donald Trump, he's supposed to be drawing blue-collar white voters, right? He's going to draw them in numbers that no one has ever seen. The latest NBC News Washington Post poll shows that Donald Trump is now at a 52% disapproval rating with non-college-educated white voters, right? He's going to get clocked. So if Trump is the candidate, you know, the odds go down. If Cruz is the candidate, the odds go slightly up because he's not a crazy person. As you may notice, I do not like Donald Trump. I've said on national television, I think that Donald Trump is, what was the poetic phrase I used? A smoking garbage heap of human debris. Thank you all for coming. Thank you for you all for engaging in free speech with me. And I'm glad that we could weather the mildly unintellectual storm outside to have a conversation with each other. Hopefully we can do this again in the future.
On behalf of the-